Programme of Action recognizes that healthy families are created by choice, not by chance.
That journey that began 25 years ago is far from over. It's now time to finish that unfinished business.
The Sustainable Development Goals cannot and will not be achieved until women, girls, and young people are able to control their bodies and their lives, free from fear and from violence.
Retreat. We will never give up. We are in a race to the finish line, and we shall prevail. Thank you. Nashukuru sana.
Good morning, everyone. Good afternoon in some parts of the country. Welcome. Bienvenidos. Konnichiwa. Bonjour. In so many different languages where we are. We have something fantastic for you today, which is our live event, What's Next? This is the sixth episode of the series of Global Thought Leadership Conversations on Nairobi Commitments, ICPD25. What a fantastic video what we saw. So what's next is basically to build on the global collaborations and collective action generated during the summit in Nairobi in November of 2019 last year. Today's dialogue will focus on achieving gender equality and inclusion and the power of partnerships. The hashtag for this event, so everybody knows and you don't forget, and you'll be your Instagram, Facebook, all the social media, is hashtag what's next for women with a four. And we encourage everyone to please post about the event, you know, your comments, your things, everything that you want to post in social media. The event also is translated into Spanish and French and accessible through the dedicated YouTube channels. It's also going to be translated into international sign language throughout the discussion. So I will be your moderator for today. My name is Nia Light, which means purpose of light. Now my birth name is another story, Carolina Marcela Manrique Benitez, and then I add my married name, which is Coyamada. So it's way easier just to call me Nia. I'm the president, co-founder and CEO of the Coyamada International Foundation, KIF. I had the pleasure to sign an amazing partnership agreement with UNFPA last December and meet Maria Rosa and Dr. Natalia Kanem. And we are so excited in our team. We have people from all over the world joining us from Kyiv. We want to definitely work in sustainability as well as helping young girls and women, empowering them through martial arts programs in order to protect them from gender-based violence. So I'm so excited to be part of this today, and I hope that all of you are, because we have a great treat for you today. My husband, Shinko Yamada, was in Nairobi last year, and he made many, many pledges. Well, two pledges, but after that, he started to do many, many partnerships around the world inspired by the work that UNFPA does. And we have seen tremendous results. So my husband is Japanese. I am Colombian. So yes, it's a long story. We speak many different languages when we travel and at home. So now I will introduce a little bit, you know, what we are going to see today. So we will have the UNFPA Executive Director, Dr. Natalia Kanem. It will be the host of this conversation. I have the pleasure to meet her last year, and her warmth, her charisma is just contagious. She will be joined by a strategic partners representing the private sector, civil society, international institutions, fashion, sport, and government to discuss the soft power that partnerships for women's rights can bring to rebuild a new model for multilateralism. The speakers will share insights and ideas on how to promote gender equality and showcase the power of partnership to bring a scale of change for women and girls and build more equal and inclusive societies. We will have amazing panelists, so I know that in some countries it's late, in some countries it's early, but we will be divided in two sessions, so please stay tuned because you're gonna love them. All of them are very powerful people. We will have the Honorable Penelope Beckles, which is the Minister of Housing and Urban Development and Member of Parliament, Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. We will also have Dr. Joyce Brown, member of the Diversity and Inclusion Advisory Council of the Prada Group and president of the Fashion Institute of Technology. We will have Dr. Samira Altuwaji, global lead on population and development at the Health, Nutrition, and Population Global Practice World Bank. We will have Dr. Daniela Ligiero, executive director and CEO of Together for Girls. We will have Claudia Lumore, founder of Glitz Africa and UNFPA Ghana Goodwill Ambassador. And we will conclude with David Evangelista, Regional President and Managing Director, Europe Eurasia Special Olympics. And we have a really big surprise for you guys. We have a performance by an amazing artist, which I can't wait to hear, DJ Switch. She's a young Ghanaian female disc jockey. She's a multi-talented entertainer who can also sing, rap, and dance, and we are delighted to welcome her today. Now, I would like to welcome officially Dr. Natalia Kanem, UNFPA Executive Director, to do her opening remarks. Let's give her a warm welcome.
Mil gracias, Nia, and I'm so happy to be here. Honorable Minister and Member of Parliament Penelope Beckles, distinguished panelists, colleagues, partners, and dear friends from all around the world, it is really my pleasure to join this terrific panel for the latest episode where UNFPA is asking the question, what's next? We thank everyone for tuning in. This is the week that marks the 26th anniversary of the Cairo International Conference on Population and Development. We're also celebrating 25 years after Beijing and that World Conference on Women. So indeed, the Cairo Programme of Action on ICPD, with its bold commitments to women's empowerment and gender equality, remains our North Star. The Nairobi Summit on ICPD galvanized public and private partners to accelerate the promise of women's equality. And the following year in Beijing, we heard that women's rights are human rights. And we showed up in Nairobi for action, not to talk. And the remarkable over 1,250 commitments that were made, including by the private sector, shows just how we can mobilize. Some $8 billion in combined new pledges were made at the Nairobi Summit last year. And that's starting to show what a broad coalition of partners can achieve together. It takes solidarity, it takes resolve. And as UNFPA enters in partnership, we do so with a spirit of humility and a desire to learn. We want to be able to share that spirit that we had all the way on the road as we marched to Nairobi and that we stand for in this session today. So UNFPA will stay with our partners. We will harness that momentum and that energy as part of our commitment from Nairobi. I have created a high-level commission on the Nairobi Summit, which will meet for the first time tomorrow It's a multi-stakeholder commission that will provide guidance and advocacy to drive those over 1,000 Nairobi commitments forward. And the vision remains that vision of the Cairo Program of Action. It's evergreen. Now, this year, the United Nations marks our 75th anniversary. We are embarking on a decade of action to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals. And of course, Sustainable Development Goal number 17, it's the hallmark of global partnerships for sustainable development. It's all about being inclusive of everyone. The COVID-19 pandemic certainly shows us how interconnected our world is, and it confirms the urgency of partnership and working together. Women and girls' rights are not negotiable. Everyone has a role to play in achieving full gender equality, and I believe that the private sector, with innovation, new ideas, bringing new resources to the table. For example, the worlds of fashion, music, sports. The private sector is indeed influential, and young people are using their power to change antiquated, old-fashioned gender norms. We're seeing academia step up to provide the evidence and the data and the analysis that we need for targeted interventions. And governments are the basis. It's government that steers domestic priorities, and civil society carries the voices of the people facing hardship and keeps power accountable. Things have changed. We need to accelerate that change and move faster. And although we have a steeper hill to climb and the road is rockier now with COVID, partnerships, that's what's going to continue to underpin our success, our progress. It was Helen Keller who once said, "Alone we can do so little, but together we can do so much." So I look forward to an engaging discussion with you today. Thank you very much, Leah. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Natalia. That was just amazing. Dr. Natalia Kanem is just an inspiration, and your words have touched us and the world, especially in this time where we are more connected than ever before, no matter where we are in the world. So let's make a little recap for the people who just join us live from all over the world. The Nairobi Summit showcased the engagement and commitment of private strategic partners and multiple sectors. Today's dialogue will feature the same variety of perspectives and insights that were at the core of the Nairobi spirit. So now we have our first three speakers. They represent the voices of government, the private sector, and experts in international organizations. Honorable Penelope Beckles, the Minister of Housing and Urban Development. You are such an excellency. You held different ministerial portfolios, served as a permanent representative of Trinidad and Tobago to the United Nations, and were the first female deputy in Parliament in 2010. You have also said that women's empowerment is the key to the effective socioeconomic and political development of our societies. However, today, still less than 25% of all national parliaments are women. Your Excellency, what can be done to expand women's representation in political decision-making process? And how can public-private partnerships promote women's participation in both the public and private affairs scenarios?
Thank you very much, Nia. And of course, let me say how happy and privileged I am to participate in this very important discussion. Let me, of course, acknowledge my sister, Dr. Natalia Kanem, Executive Director, UNFPA, and my fellow panelists. I am so happy for that video clip of the Nairobi Summit. I was not able to attend, but at least I got an opportunity to see, to get a little peep into what the summit was like. And I want to take this opportunity to congratulate Natalia and the UNFPA for a well-organized and excellent summit. Now, the 75th anniversary of the United Nations presents an ideal opportunity for reflection and introspection of the benefit of multilateralism in resolving global challenges maintaining world peace and advancing social progress. While it is indeed important to recognize this milestone, we have a responsibility to go beyond a mere symbolic commemoration as we enter the decade of action to deliver the 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. The strides in development made globally by the United Nations system, including through its entities such as UNFPA and UN Women specifically, with respect to human rights, poverty eradication, gender equality, must be applauded. However, we remain cognizant of the challenges that we are yet to overcome. So in the context of the question that you have asked, I'd like to say that my country, Trinidad and Tobago, is viewed in international settings as quite successful with regard to women's representation and participation in politics. Our women have made remarkable strides in ensuring that females are not only represented in prominent positions nationally, but also internationally. Female parliamentarians in my region have contributed to the development and adoption of several important instruments, such as the United Nations and Commonwealth resolutions, conventions, as well as action plans, and continue to play a significant role in raising awareness on issues of gender equality and women's empowerment. Now, while there have been many advancements in respect of gender equality in my region, there is still a lot more that could be done, as women's political participation remains unequal. Therefore, I wish to underscore the importance of undertaking initiatives aimed at empowering our women to ensure women's full participation on an equal basis with men. There is a need to change social norms in respect of how women are seen within Parliament. To achieve this, mandatory sensitization and capacity building sessions geared towards raising awareness and increasing knowledge of gender equality. Now, one interesting thing, even in my country, that I would like to share is that the Honorable Prime Minister, Dr. Keith Rowley, he under his portfolio is gender affairs. So therefore, as Prime Minister of Trinidad and Tobago, he has taken responsibility for gender affairs. And as a leader, I think that's a great decision, and it would certainly help towards dealing with the issue of gender equality and gender sensitization. So one of the decisions, of course, could be that leaders of respective countries can consider taking the portfolio of gender specifically dealing with gender issues, give themselves that responsibility, and therefore they have in terms of the decision making process, they can certainly set policies that can address some of the inequalities as it relates to gender equality. Now, it is important that we continue to work to create a society where women and girls are treated as equal partners in the development of our respective countries, and we must lead the change by our own actions rather than good intentions through advocacy, mentorship, and knowledge sharing. A key aspect of increasing women's representation is by engaging and working with political parties, which can have mentorship programs and serve as a source of supporting and shaping future leadership roles, particularly women helping women. Hazel Brown, a national activist and founding member of the Network of NGO of Trinidad and Tobago for the Advancement of Women, notes a certain level of preparation, mental and otherwise, is necessary when a woman intends to offer herself for political service. We cannot take women and drop them into a system that is male-dominated and working against them and expect them to succeed without the support of other women, unquote. I believe that a sound education creates an excellent foundation, and in this regard, we must continue to create opportunities for learning for our women and girls. We must also ensure that they are equipped with the tools necessary for their own self-development, such as technology, access to healthcare, mental health, counseling services, and career guidance. Now, the cabinet of which I have the pleasure to serve, there are 23 members of cabinet, and 8 members of the cabinet that I serve are women. at present in Trinidad and Tobago, we have the first female president. The leader of the opposition is also female. The president of the Senate, as well as the Speaker of the House of Representatives. And I think that is an indication of the role that women are playing in Trinidad and Tobago. And as I speak of education has been free at the primary level, at the secondary level, and there are scholarships available at the tertiary level. And I think women, both in Trinidad and Tobago and the Caribbean, they have all taken the opportunities of free education to advance themselves. And finally, I would just say that civic education in schools is also important, whereby there should be an emphasis on integrity, service, and gender equality. And change must start at an early age, and this can be further supplemented by gender awareness campaigns for the general public. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Minister Penelope. This was so inspiring. Wow, amazing that Trinidad Tobago has so many women in positions of power politically. Our next guest is Dr. Joyce Brown. She's the president of the Fashion Institute of Technology. Now, Joyce, you are a member of the Diversity and Inclusion Advisory Board that was established by the company Prada in 2019 and co-chaired by the director and producer Ava DuVernay, an artist activist, Fister Gates. Prada also supported the attendance of youth delegates at the Nairobi Summit. The board aims to elevate voices of color within the company and the fashion industry at large. So Dr. Joyce, what actions has this board recommended and what lessons can be learned regarding how to build more equal systems for women and especially women of color?
Thank you, Nia. And to my fellow panelists, I say good morning. And to Dr. Kanem, thank you for inviting me to be part of this very impressive panel. You know, Prada made a commitment to embrace and to listen to diverse voices and to allow the lessons learned to influence their processes and their products. And consequently, they formed this autonomous council, really for the purpose of gaining insight and advice to build a more diverse and inclusive business culture. So to date, the company has gathered data by surveying the workforce and then initiating training at both the corporate and the retail employee level to recognize and confront unconscious and implicit bias, microaggressions, stereotypical reactions, and then to look at the impact of those beliefs and behaviors on current practices in recruitment and hiring and promotion within the ranks. You know, to have the need to correct for these biases in corporate America is not unique. What is unique is to find a company like Prada willing to recognize and own their behavior and to make a public and sustained effort to do something about it. So the Prada Group is taking the lessons learned from the data, and they've made a twofold commitment. One is to hire a director for diversity and inclusion. And the other is to demonstrate their commitment to building diversity in their employee ranks by supporting educational opportunities and creating access to those opportunities through diverse, equitable, and inclusive channels. Now, one way to do that is by developing programs that support a diverse pipeline of talented minority students and providing internships and apprenticeships and mentoring so that their talent will be honed and recognized and they'll be primed to compete on their merits, to be hired and ultimately to transcend to leadership positions in the industry. You know, in any business, one has to balance business objectives with societal demands. And the company recognized the critical importance of public-private partnerships with educational institutions, with programs with the United Nations, with community and cultural groups, in order to broaden the base of their inclusive activities. So we all need to recognize that while talent is probably distributed equally in any society, opportunity is not. And Prada is making a concerted effort to identify avenues that will make a difference in the communities in which it operates. So how does one have a particular impact on elevating and empowering women of color? By respecting them, by recognizing talent where it exists and celebrating and providing the support and the opportunity to advance, even if it means taking a chance, taking a risk, and trusting that the talent you suspect is there really is. So I'm very proud to be a member of this council, and I will certainly look forward to being a significant partner and through other programs that FIT has developed as part of our own social justice collaborative.
Wow, Joyce, that's absolutely amazing. I love that at this point in our culture and what's happening with all the world, you know, that Prada will definitely create a position for a leader on diversity and inclusion. It's really admirable. So, Joyce, what role can the private sector have in promoting gender equality and inclusion?
You know, when we talk about soft power, it's really an extremely powerful force. There are two areas in my life and work that might be considered soft, but are probably the most powerful forces in life-changing ways. One is education, which is really the most transformative of forces in our society. It's the great equalizer. When you educate, you empower. You build competence, and therefore you build confidence. You provide tools that can never be taken away. And if you empower a woman, you inspire a generation of young girls. The other area is fashion. And through fashion, you inspire self-expression. You build the confidence to own your own identity and to make a statement that you want the world to hear and what you want them to know about you. So through an investment of resources, there are many ways that the private sector can promote gender equality and inclusion, through scholarship support for education, through mentoring to ensure that women and girls are recognized and valued through the talent identification. You know, we often speak about the 1% in our society. Many that are included in the 1% are, quite frankly, simply lucky. And the 99% get left out. But being lucky does not mean you're smart. It only means that you are privileged and well-connected. Companies committed to change have to be willing to take risks on individuals with no network and no connections. All they have to bring to the table is talent. Prada is committed to supporting young people who might otherwise be excluded from the conversation, and that was demonstrated by their support for young people to participate in the Nairobi conference, which made a meaningful imprint on the consciousness of those young girls. So one may choose not to recognize the forces behind the movements that are at first glance considered soft, but to commit to ensuring a sustainable and circular economy, to commit to protecting the environment, to commit to creating sustainable fashion that celebrates the distinct nature of gender equality, to commit to taking a risk by supporting minority artisans with nothing more than talent to offer, really does create a transformative and powerful force that pervades our environment with soft but impactful voices.
Thank you so much, Dr. Joyce. Your words are very inspiring. And I think it really reaches out to everyone that is listening today and that has tuned in, because there is so much talent in the world. And, you know, you as a powerhouse are inspiring the next generation and the women that come behind us, you know, to reach higher and to believe in their creativity. And that is just so beautiful and needed in the world. Thank you so much. Our next guest and panelist is Dr. Samira Altuwaidri. I did practice this because it's a very beautiful name, but I always like to pronounce the names correctly because usually they mispronounce my name everywhere I go. But Dr. Samira Your work highlights that investments in primary health care, including family planning, reproductive, and maternal health, empowers women and girls to have more control over their lives and well-being and helps them achieve their potential. This message was also at the core of the Nairobi statement formulated after 6 months of global consultations with hundreds of organizations and thousands of people involved. However, women and girls continue to face many underlying structural barriers to health. So Dr. Samira, what impact does the fight against gender inequality have on health and development outcomes?
Thank you very much, Nia. Thank you for pronouncing my name correctly. I really appreciate it. It gets mutilated all the time. And thanks to UNFPA and Dr. Kanem for this invitation. Dr. Kanem, your dedication and passion are undeniable. I cannot add anything to this, but I wanted to take a second and thank your team. I've been working with for the last 2 weeks to come here, and it's obvious the inspiration and the dedication there. So thank you for inspiring all of us around the world. On the impact of the fight against gender inequality on health and development, I just want to stop at development at the beginning and probably take a couple of minutes to talk about health and health attributes when it comes to gender equality. And I think we just need to agree on the semantics of the situation that gender inequalities do exist across the life course, from the missing girls at birth and gender-based nutritional differences while growing up, to access and utilization of health services, especially reproductive, maternal and health services, and health outcomes at an old age. So the cost of gender inequality is big. And I would like to refer to a report that was authored by the World Bank this year, right before the International Women's Day in March, which actually talks about the gender dividend. And that is that the world would gain about $170 trillion by closing the gaps in lifetime labor earnings between women and men. Imagine what can we do with $172 trillion when it comes to the basic indicators betterment when it comes to the SDGs. And on per capita basis, gender inequality in earnings could lead to losses in the wealth of about $24,000 per person globally. These losses differ, of course, between regions and countries because the levels of human capital wealth and thereby losses in wealth due to gender inequality tend to increase in absolute values with economic development. So for these reasons, in absolute terms alone, the losses are largest in the OECD countries. Now, when we come to the impact of the gender inequality on health, I want to stop at three pillars. I want to stop at universal health coverage very quickly, human capital formulation, and finally COVID-19, because no conversation is complete without the COVID-19 these days. So there are many gendered pathways of health outcome and human capital formulation, and I'm going to stop at two: nutrition, where there is a gender differential in nutrition, and the impact on physical growth and mental development at all ages, and also the effect on learning capacity and educational outcomes when it comes to school enrollment, especially early childhood education. And we know that investment in education alone can carry very far when it comes to not just the earnings and the competitiveness in the labor market, but also on health, because we know that educated women marry later. And I always advocate that the biggest deterrent of child and early marriage is education, it's girls' education. We also know that educated women have less children and they have antenatal care, they have institutional deliveries, they have less under five mortality and infant mortality. We also know that women who have the dignity of roofs above their heads and food on their tables make better choices, not just for themselves, but also for their families. So that limited control over decision-making and the path to gender equality carries very far when it comes to actually girls' education, when it comes to competitiveness in the labor market, when it comes to access to health, especially universal health coverage, and the human capital accumulation, and it's intergenerational. because we know that girls born to poor women, poor girls sometimes, because they marry so early, tend to be poor themselves, and so on and so forth. When it comes to gender equality and how does it matter for the universal health coverage, we know that women make better choices. I just said, just not just for themselves, but also for their families. And the gender roles affect access, availability, and affordability of health services. We know that the catastrophic health spending or out of pocket is highest in female-headed households. It's also highest in women who have less access to health care. There is also a link between gender and service provision when it comes to the human resources for health. We know that the female health workers make the bulk of the health personnel. And also, we need to stop at the legal and policy opportunities for health services for vulnerable groups, like, you know, girls, women in fragility, conflict, and violence situation. And finally, we need to ensure that gender equality in access and provision of health services is also important for achieving the proxies that actually lead to improvement of health outcomes, mainly nutrition and education. And finally, I just want to stop at the pandemic. Of course, the pandemic was unsurpassed. I think we haven't seen anything like this in a century. So I just wanted to stop at some of the things that we have done at the bank to actually ensure that our clients, whether they are low income or high income, have the benefit of the interventions, but also there is a gender thread that actually cuts across all of our projects and our work and our technical and analytical products. So we had around 88 COVID-19 emergency projects that were approved in a fairly short time between April 2nd and June 30th. And one of the things that we were very keen on looking at is gender-based violence, sexual exploitation, abuse and harassment, provision of routine or essential health services, which includes but not limited to maternal and reproductive health, awareness building and communication strategies for targeted population, mental health, including coping mechanisms, support for caregivers, which tend to be women most of the time, and women in decision-making when it comes to communities, localities, governments, and national institutions. And we insisted on having indicators to measure all of this, plus any innovations that were actually pertinent at that point in time. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Samira. That is such great information. Now tell us, what are some effective empowerment approaches that mobilize communities to improve maternal and child health from your perspective?
I think community engagement and participation had been on the table for a very long time. I think we did learn the lesson that we cannot just zoom in and zoom out. We need to leave some impact and we need to empower people. And one of the things that I personally always advocate for is that we need to toss the ball back sometimes to the community in itself. What does this mean? It means we need to be very cognizant and systematic in strengthening the ownership of the outcome. Identify local champions, compare and contrast among local communities, involve people who are viewed as leaders within the community, religious leaders, for example. And I could talk about many lessons learned from my own practice, especially in remote areas, whereby people listen to their local leaders because there's a trust that's been built for a very long time. The second point is that health programs or interventions for maternal and newborn health have traditionally been either passive, meaning that it's a top-down health service improvement, health service provision, or active, which is really a bottom-up mobilization of communities to increase care seeking. I would propose that we probably need to have community participation opportunities for health programs to be introduced as a top-down ideas, but are executed through a bottom-up approach. This ensures what I have been talking about in my first point, which is ownership of the outcome and what have you. And finally, I think we need to strengthen the concepts of value of health as a societal, religious, community, and individual beliefs. I think the value of health had not been looked at in terms of what does it exactly mean to individuals and communities and families and population at large. I think there is a basic conceptual belief that people value their health, but I think we need to build on that and probably take it a bit forward by holding people accountable for their own health, plus all the health services provision that we can provide them. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Samira. That is so valuable, especially nowadays, because definitely our health comes first, physically, mentally, and emotional, especially with all of this going on and that we don't know what is going to happen. So I think having experts like you and that you have dedicated your life, you know, to healthcare, and you went to Harvard and you work at the UN and you're just so, so, so passionate about it. I think this is amazing for everybody that will have the treat today, you know, to hear your perspective and all the great points that you made. I want to thank all the distinguished speakers for the discussion. This has been an amazing first session. Please don't go anywhere for all our live audience. We are just going to announce a fantastic performance coming soon, and then we will have our next session with our next panelists. So thank you so much, Honorable Penelope Beckles, Dr. Joyce Brown, and Dr. Samira Altuwaiji. Now we will have the special treat. I'm so excited. So I would like to introduce you to DJ Switch. Oh my gosh, she's so cute and beautiful and brings such a pure and love and joy, you know, to today's event. DJ Switch is a 12-year-old artist from Ghana who has already made a name for herself after spinning, that's how you do, right? The young generation, after spinning for just 3 years. She won Ghana's Most Talented Kids 2017 competition and became the youngest person to win Ghana's annual DJ award last year. She recently founded the DJ Switch Foundation, advocating for quality education, adequate healthcare, gender equality, and sustainable development. She's also the ambassador of the Because I Want to Be initiative launched by the First Lady of the Republic of Ghana to reintegrate girls who dropped out of school for one reason or another back into the school system. Imagine she has accomplished all of this and she's just 12. So I can just imagine what she's gonna do when she's 20. We are so delighted to have you. Welcome, DJ Switch.
Thank you so much. I need to introduce myself, right?
Yes, whatever you want, you are free.
Yeah, thank you. So I'm a 12-year-old Erica Tando, known as DJ Switch Ghana, from Ghana, who started spinning for 3 years now. And there have been several challenges as a girl DJ. And what I do to overcome said challenges is that I consistently do not underestimate my own talent. And, you know, when you were a new DJ or a newcomer in an office or any task, it is natural to feel inferior to those who have paved the way for you. For that, it is very natural. You know, you go to an office and then they tell you your job is to sit behind the computer as a receptionist, and although you know everything about the computer, you'd be like, how do we do this? But you know it, so it's natural to feel inferior, and your confidence wouldn't be that high when it happens that way. So you need to prove yourself wrong for not being adequate enough, solely because the secret lies in your ability. Ask your predecessors about what you want to do, what you have to do, like what you are doing, and I mean, should I say what you are about to do? As them, you know, as a DJ, although there are some people who have names that are bigger than Jupiter, but when you listen to their mix, you won't really feel their mix. If you're somebody who have the ears and the eyes for music and you really understand, you really get that what they are doing isn't on the right path. But you need to ask them questions like, how did you do this on the radio station, on TV? Although, you know, it makes them feel that you are also part of them. And you also share your ideas on what you did to them, and we all learn together. Yeah. And then, okay, so there's this thing that have been going on all around the world, and my take on that, and that is the domestic violence and the gender-based violence, is that, you know, in our community there are some adults that addresses children wives and husband, and I think it is wrong. It is very, very wrong. Why? Because it you know, so far as the child has ears to hear, they understand it. And if you keep addressing kids, children as wives and children, and it's not only such words like wives and children, there are some words, there's some sugar code words like my daughter, my son, which also leads to rape. It leads to early marriages, because, you know, there are some mothers knowingly, when adults call their children wives and husbands, they'll be like, oh, your husband is here, your wife is in the house, and did you bring something for your wife? Did you bring something for your husband? And it leads to early marriage, because you see that the person who is addressing your child as wife or husband can break an exercise book, and you'd be like, oh, your husband brought an exercise book, take it to school, which leads to rape. And I'll also say that parents should also avoid labeling their children, saying, oh, this is my son, he's smarter than this other daughter of mine and stuff. It should be equal. And that is what we talk about, gender equality, and include children in conversations like what you are doing. You've gotten to know what we suffer about, our ideas. So you always need to include children in your conversations. And when you are addressing a child with set words, it depends on the voice and your facial expressions that you are using to address such child. And I think it should be noted.
Wow, DJ Switch, Erica, you said it right like it is. Amazing, coming from a 12-year-old girl. I am so proud of you, and I am sure that your parents must be so proud of you. I think any parent would love to have a child like you. And the things that you said are so pure, and they really come from your heart and your perspective. And you are so right. It's so important to include children in every conversation and every event, because you guys are the future generation. You know, you're going to continue to lead this world. And so now we have a surprise, which is one of your performances and a video. So let's watch it. Thank you.
Gender-based violence now. I'm out. Switch up. Peace.
The Swag DJ. DJ Switch.
Wow, that is fantastic.
Thank you.
Wonderful, DJ Switch. Thank you so much. You are so talented. You had Thank me you. Dancing right there, bringing the Colombia and the Caribbean out of me. That's great. Thank you so much. This has been such a treat, and you have such a great future. And thank you for participating and for your participation and you know, your opinion on gender equality. I think it has reached all the audience around the world, coming from a young girl like you. And I have no doubt in my mind that you will just go anywhere that you want and achieve anything that you want. Thank you, DJ Switch. So that was a great performance for everybody who just joined us or who has been with us for the morning. It's just really amazing. We will go into our next three speakers, and I'm gonna do a little recap, you know, from what we had this morning. So we had some really amazing points, you know, from Honorable Penelope Beckles from Trinidad and Tobago. You know, she pointed out that there has been three members of cabinet that are women, and a lot of women in her country have amazing political positions. So that's really good to learn from. How did they get there? How such an amazing country, and as an example for the rest of the world, can appoint women for leader positions in politics. We also have great points, you know, from Dr. Joyce Brown, where Prada is committed, you know, because this whole theme is like the follow-up to the Nairobi ICPD of last year, you know, like the power of soft partnerships. What are we doing, you know, as partners, as women, as men, as corporations, as companies, as social people, to empower women and to help, you know, develop the next step for the future generations. So Prada has committed to create a leadership position for diversity and inclusion, which is great. We also had Dr. Samira Altuwaishri. She shared some amazing points about health. And she did mention, to go back a little bit on the COVID-19 and, you know, the repercussions that this would have in women and young ladies, you know, from around the world where they have programs and, you know, a lot of things have been shut down, and the importance of our health to take care of our physical health and also our mental health. So this has just been a little recap. So now we would like to welcome our next three guests. They represent the voices of global advocacy to end violence against girls, fashion and influencers, and sports. So we have Dr. Daniela Ligiero. You are heading Together for Girls, which is a global public-private partnership dedicated to ending violence against children. with a particular focus on sexual violence against girls. This partnership brings together national government, UN agencies, and private sector organizations. One essential pillar of the model is global advocacy and public awareness to highlight solutions and amplify the voices of survivors. Dr. Daniela, share with us, please. In the wake of social justice movements like Me Too, what are some effective strategies to shed light on the violence that disproportionately affect women and girls?
Thank you so much, Nia. It's such a pleasure to be with you here today. I just want to start by saying, DJ Switch, thank you. Thank you for your energy, for your light, for your wisdom, for your power. I was so deeply moved, and I'm going to carry that with me. Thank you. Thank you also to the UNFPA team who put this together, and to Natalia. Thank you. Your unwavering leadership is needed more than ever. So thanks so much. Yeah, I want to say three things about movements that I think are really important. And you know, you referenced Me Too, but we have sister movements all over the world that have been talking about the issue of gender-based violence. The first is the ability of these movements to raise awareness about the magnitude of the problem. This is a massive problem, and we've known for a while because of our data. About 1 in 3 girls and women experience some form of sexual gender-based violence in their lifetime, and 1 in 10 boys actually experience sexual violence in childhood and adolescence. And you know, before we used to call this the single largest silent pandemic of our time, and now we're calling it the shadow pandemic. So movements have the ability to raise awareness about the problem and to create space for survivor voices. You know, as a survivor myself, who's been telling my story for over 10 years now, you know, the power of stories and survivors coming forward really helps amplify the magnitude of the problem. So that's the first. The second is something you talked about, Nia, is the focus on solutions. If all we do is say there's a problem, that's kind of depressing. But if you can then focus in on, we actually know that there are programs and policies and actions that people, governments, and others can take. It doesn't have to be this way. That's very powerful. And the third piece about movements really is about this idea that everyone has a role to play. So whether you're a 12-year-old DJ, or you're a minister, or you're running a fashion industry, you know, government, civil society leaders, parents, teachers, we all have a role to play when it comes to ending sexual and gender-based violence. And within our own spheres, we have to create the kind of groundswell and normative change that's needed and that puts the voices and experiences of survivors at the center.
Wow, thank you so much, Dr. Daniela. That is so touching too. And it is true, everyone has a role to play. And I think everyone feels included, you know, with your perspective and your answer, that we can all actually do something and take action. So Daniela, tell us, what can be done to ensure that this issue is front and center in the public debate, especially given the increased risk due to COVID-19 measures?
Yeah, thanks for that. You know, we're a partnership, as you mentioned before, a public-private partnership that really values data and evidence. So I think one of the important things we need is to continue to strengthen data and evidence to understand what's really happening and then what works to resolve it. At this point at Together for Girls with our partners, and I want to say special thanks to UNFPA for being a partner of Together for Girls and for walking on this journey with us for the last 10 years. You know, we now have data for over 10% of the world's population under 24 when it comes to violence. And we've known for a long time that this is a massive problem. UNFPA has recently released some really interesting data showing that because of COVID, we estimate an additional 13 million cases of child marriage, and that by 2030, we will have had an extra 200 million cases of gender-based violence. So this is really horrifying, you know, the increases we're seeing with COVID, both because of increased violence in the home and online, but also because we can't do the kinds of prevention and programs that we need to do. But this increase that UNFPA has mapped is the tip of the iceberg. Before that, we were talking about billions of people experiencing sexual and gender-based violence in their lifetime. And so I think one of the important things to understand is that before we had a massive problem. And so when we talk about kind of going back to normal, you know, I want to urge us not to go back to normal. We cannot go back to normal. You know, my fellow Brazilian, Paulo Coelho, often says that the only thing tragedy gives us is the opportunity to rebuild our life. So this is an opportunity to rebuild better. We can't go back to the way it was. We need to elevate our ambition and really create a world where girls and women and children are safe from gender-based violence. And I know, and I know you know, and that's why you're putting this, you know, panel together, that no single sector or actor is going to do this alone. And so we have to work in partnership. We have to strengthen the partnerships we have already and expand them. We have to create new, you know, creative, ambitious partnerships to really take us to the next level. And so, you know, we at Together for Girls stand ready with all of you and with UNFPA to really meet this moment. And I'm just really grateful to be with you here today having this conversation. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Dr. Daniela. And it's just so inspiring, everything you said. And I love Paulo Coelho. I mean, like, it's just such a great author. I read most of his books when I was a child. And so inspiring, everything you've said. And yes, we all have a role to play, and we all have to be together, united, in order to change the world. And I love that of not going back to normal, because we keep saying, let's go back to normal. When are we going to go back to normal? But you're absolutely right. We need to advance and evolve and create a better future for the next generations and women and young girls. Our next speaker is Claudia Lumore. Claudia, you are a powerhouse. You are the founder of Glitz Africa, that includes Ghana Women of the Year honors, Glitz Africa Fashion Week, Glitz Style Awards, Glitz Africa Living Magazine, and Glitz Africa Care Foundation. You received multiple accolades and awards for your entrepreneurship skills through the years. You also worked in the banking industry. While both male and female entrepreneurs face constraints as a lack of capital, women are specifically impacted by a number of obstacles, such as discrimination and lesser access to assets. So, Claudia, share with us, what can be done to support women entrepreneurs better?
Can you hear you? I think, sorry.
Yes,
we can hear you. Thank you very much. It's been such an inspiring, it's afternoon for us here. So thank you, UNFPA. Thank you, Natalia. Thank you, everyone, for having me here. I think for me, this topic, what you're discussing, is very personal for me because I'm a woman entrepreneur myself. And being on this journey for the last 11 years, in an environment that everybody told me that what I was about to do was not possible. Where was the money to do it? Everybody was telling you that you are either crazy, it wouldn't work, who was going to read a magazine, who cares about fashion, who cares about empowering women. It's been a very emotional, nerve-wracking, you know, journey to be on for the last year. So I really believe in 2020, if women are still struggling, as women entrepreneurs, there's so much that has to be done. I think the first thing I will share is institutional support, because the support is there, because most of the time I will ask people, or I meet a lot of women, and they will tell me, we don't even know where to go for funding. And people will say the support is there. But sometimes I feel the support is there, but maybe it's in the books. Who is making them accessible? Who is advocating around this? Who is communicating the support that is available to women? So I think that's one thing that I want to urge organizations and institutions to do. It's all well and good to have in your books or in policies to say, okay, we want to do this for women entrepreneurs. This is what we want to achieve. But how are you communicating that to the actual women on the ground? I think that's always been my issue, because we know they're there, but we don't know how to access it. We don't know. And also sometimes the system that is in place to even get these women to access this funding is just so discouraging. I haven't had any support in the last 11 years. So that's number one. And this is somebody that I even engage at a level that I know about some of these funding. So how much more some of the women that we that are doing soap making somewhere in, you know, in the remote area, the caterer who's trying to, you know, start a catering company, how do they hear about these support systems? So I think there should be a lot more work around that in supporting women. I am more of an action person. I think everybody that knows me will tell you this, that I'm more of a go-getter action person. And I want to see this, you know, support that is available, ready and accessible for women who really needs it, and not just, you know, us having it in books and talking about them. I think one other thing that for me, going through my journey and how lonely it was for me on this journey as a woman entrepreneur, one thing that was very clear for me was networking as women. So I think one of the key first thing that I created on my platform is called She Boss and She Summit. These are platforms that are bringing women entrepreneurs together. We're there to lift each other up, to tap each other on the shoulder and say, you know what, you can do this. Share business cards. The energy is always so positive. That's my energy all the time. You can't bring me down with negative energy. That I won't even allow you. So it's always been, how do we bring other women together and encourage them that, you know what, whatever you're doing, you can do this. So I think platforms like that, I have seen it from personal experiences, people crying, you know, women, you know, it's just such a beautiful platform. And I would encourage all of us, you know, wherever your institution is, even in banks, because I've encouraged a lot of corporate people I work with to have women networking within their organizations. And it is helping a lot, you know, in corporate. Sometimes we feel like, oh, we work in a bank, we work in a big organization, corporate organization. But there's a need to have platforms for women in that institution to come together and to support each other in the institution. So I believe that if we can create networks like this, using our own influence, using our own institution to create platforms like this, network like this, it would be great. And yeah, and I think also, we are talking about partnerships. So partnerships to bring in traditional leaders for me also will be great. Because from where we are always limited by culture as well. You know, can we allow women to grow? Can we allow women to flourish without people telling us that, okay, you have to be married by a certain age. You need to have kids at a certain age. You need to be home cooking and looking after your kids. I have been targeted most of the time. People say, Claudia, you're always in the office at 9 p.m., 8 p.m. Who's looking after your kids? Okay, would my husband be asked that question if he was in the office at 9 p.m.? So I think these are conversations we need to have. And we shouldn't be embarrassed by it, you know, as women to say that, you know what, I've got support, somebody to help me, my husband to help me, and our men, I mean, that are supporting us and being part of raising our kids. You know, well done to all of you. And we need more of you to support us like that. But I love conversations like that, culture conversation with our leaders to make it okay for women to be out there to work. And not, you know, limit us with our culture that you can't do this, you can't achieve this, you have to be married by this. It limits a lot of women. So I think these are some of the key things that I will say as personally is, you know, it's impacted my journey as a woman, and with sharing and being, you know, with lots of women, I know it's something that affects a lot of women as well. So I think, yeah, that would be some of the things that I will share.
Wow, that is amazing, Claudia. You made some really amazing points. You know, I admire you a lot. I admire all the women here and men, but also for, you know, to listen to the no-sayers and pursue your dream and start by yourself, you know, with no funding as an entrepreneur. It requires an inner strength, tremendous inner strength. You know, to follow your dream and to inspire other women entrepreneurs that will follow your steps. Thank you so much. So our next question, Claudia, is What role can the influencers like yourself, media, and creativity play in promoting gender equality and inclusion?
I think this is, thank you for that, because it's such a powerful question. And I always say when I get a platform to talk, I always speak to, because of the position I say, being a publisher and a magazine owner, I engage and have access to a lot of influencers, whether they're movie, fashion, musicians, and all of that. And every time my question to them is, what is your purpose? Your talent has brought you here, but what is our purpose? Why are we here? I think as influencers, once we know the purpose of why we are here, it will be easier for us to use our platform in a positive way to change the narrative a little bit. So for me, first and foremost, like, I am very clear, you know, it took me a long time, but I'm very clear what my purpose is and, you know, where I sit and the power of where I sit and what I can impact in a very small way as well. So I think that media, for instance, you know, there's a lot of bad media when it comes to women, and, you know, we've been tagged in a very sexual way in movies and all of these things. So I think media can, you know, play a very huge role in making sure that content are very transformative content, and also influencers as well, making sure that we are putting out content that are inspiring people, empowering women. Our platform, for instance, we do a lot of digital campaign around what success means to women. We use a lot of influence to do this. We have a campaign actually running now on I said no consent, no sex. It's something I'm very passionate about. And we're filming that with key influencers in media, in fashion, in music, all of that running on digital. And also using the magazine. So for me, my passion is use all my platform to see how we can empower women. I think very clearly when you state Glitz Africa, everybody knows that it's an inspirational brand to empower women. So I think as influencers and as media, we need to understand the position that we are. We need to understand the space that we operate in and make sure that our content are positive content that's, you know, to change the narrative. That is what I would say. And also, with everything that we're doing and with UNFPA, I clearly realized that the job is just really too big. And in that sense, we came up with Friends of UNFPA. I think it's something that UNFPA is doing globally that is fantastic. And I spoke to the Ghana team in Ghana. They've been hugely supportive. We launched it last year. We have our first inaugural meeting. We brought on, because for me, that's when we speak about partnership. That's what it is for me. Because just UNFPA Ghana and just Claudia Lumo platforms will not serve the whole purpose. We won't achieve a lot. So partnering with other influencers, partnering with corporate people, and it was such a very powerful thing that people were just running towards us to say, how can I help? How can I be part of it? So positive feedbacks. So I think platforms like that is something really great for influencers and media people to use our platform and our impact wherever we are. And I think Dr. Natalia said it really right, bang on. He said, we all have a role to play. That was it for me, like everything together. We all have a role to play wherever you are, whether you're on TV as an influencer, social media, print, events. For me, no great event will happen without a UNFPA content on it. And it's not because of just UNFPA, it's just because I believe in what they're doing when it comes to maternal health. Childcare is something that is the soul of what I believe in. So we all need to know the purpose and use our platforms well.
Wow, Claudia. Yes. Very good. Great. Very inspiring. I mean, we have a lot of common. My husband and I are in the philanthropic, but also in entertainment industry here in Hollywood. So I agree with everything that you say. It's very powerful. Thank you so much. And now we will introduce our next panelist and our last panelist, David Evangelista. David is the regional president and managing director, Euro-Asia of the Special Olympics. The Special Olympics supports over 6 million athletes, 1 million coaches and volunteers, more than 100,000 competitions each year in more than 190 countries. Through the power of sports, people with intellectual disabilities discover new strengths and abilities, skills and successes. This was exemplified during the Nairobi Summit session titled "The Revolution is Inclusion, Sports and Empowerment," that talked about the impactful role of sport in improving the lives of men, women, and children. This is also where you signed a new global partnership with UNFPA, right, David? So tell us, David, what are the specific barriers that women and girls with intellectual disabilities face in realizing their rights?
Well, thank you very much, Nia. And let me just start by thanking UNFPA, the incredible leadership of Dr. Kanem, the great efforts of Maria Rosa and the entire team. It's an honor to represent the movement of Special Olympics and girls with intellectual disabilities worldwide. I'd also like to just take a quick moment. Can we just give a quick virtual round of applause to DJ Swift again? What a tremendous performance. I think all of us have a lot to learn. I think all of us probably fall into the trap of underestimating our talent. And I did not wake up this morning thinking that a 12-year-old Ghanaian girl would change my entire perspective. And I think that's one of the many impacts that this call will have for all of us. Tremendous from the last session and Daniela with the organization Together for Girls, which has been a huge actor in this space. Incredible to learn about Claudia's work in Blitz. Just a wonderful, wonderful display of solidarity, but also of power. Girls with intellectual disabilities regrettably face, as they would say in the vernacular, a double whammy. Not only do they face the stigma of being a girl, namely in the developing world, but also with an intellectual disability, with syndromes and conditions such as Down syndrome, autism, they face almost unspeakable barriers and challenges to living a life of dignity, a life of opportunity, and a life of empowerment, which is why the partnership that we share with UNFPA is by far one of the most prioritized and one of the most exciting. What are the challenges? The challenges really come down to both social, economic, a lot of cultural barriers, all of which, as Daniela said, we've known about for, if not decades, centuries, and the solutions are readily available. One of those solutions has come through the UNFPA agency and their incredible support, not only in empowering girls on and off the field of play, but also amplifying their voice. We all know that girls across the world, whether it be in developed or developing economies, face specific challenges, but particularly girls with intellectual disabilities are often cast away. We've seen the stories of their inability to be educated because of simple biological processes like menstruation. How can a girl be left out of the education system because of a process upon which mankind fully depends? It's quite astonishing. We must do better. And to use the sports metaphor that Dr. Kanem used, we are in this race to the finish line. We must finish this race together. Special Olympics is a proud partner in helping finish that race. But more importantly, I think, Nia, some of the barriers also have to do with educating parents, educating families, educating communities to think differently. I think very differently about music now, having watched DJ Swift. I think very differently now about the role that economic empowerment can have in forging real gender equity through the presentation made from Claudia. So a lot of it has to come with having the tough discussion. UNFPA has specialized in this space. You need to look no further than the Let's Talk series that was produced with Natalia Vodianova and Dr. Kanem and Antalya Turkey, really bringing to the forefront some edgy discussion, breaking down taboo. And I think in large part, girls with intellectual disabilities are at the starting line. They're ready for that gun to sound. They want to run that race. It's our job to make that sound go off. It's our job to provide the track. And it's our job to ensure that at the end of that finish line, there's crowds and crowds, an entire global community, not only cheering their sport performance, but using that performance as a metaphor to bring about a life of dignity, a life of opportunity, a life of empowerment, and a life of achievement. So I believe that all of the challenges we're facing, challenges that are not unique to Special Olympics, we can overcome them, but we must overcome them together. And I'll just make a quick mention that the movement of Special Olympics is actually rooted deeply in gender equity. Our founder is Eunice Kennedy Shriver, a woman, sister of the late John F. Kennedy. Some of our biggest champions, Donna DeVerona, one of the most iconic female Olympic athletes in the world. We have great support from so many, Michelle Kwan, as I said, Natalia Vodianova, and so many more. But Special Olympics is a movement globally, takes very seriously the issues facing girls and mothers across the world, and we couldn't be prouder of doing this work together.
That's amazing, David. I know that you touched a little bit on how is a sport a vehicle to promote their equality and inclusion. Share a little bit with us about this second part of the question, as well as what we were discussing, that sports brings more, you know, sure, for mental health during COVID-19.
Absolutely. You know. Absolutely. In fact, we could have never have imagined in January 1st of this year that the platform supporting people with intellectual disabilities through physical activity would become so pronounced by through a crisis. You know, in Mandarin, the characters for crisis, I believe, are risk and opportunity, and you put them together and they create the word for crisis. Well, girls with intellectual disabilities are facing heightened risk, but we also have an opportunity to mitigate that risk for them. Sport is a proven mechanism in the development space, not only to provide the very direct benefits of physical activity, but releasing of endorphins, feeling the energy of competition, the joy of scoring a goal or scoring a basket or finishing the race. But there's so much more there that all of us need to harness as we harness advocacy, as we harness fashion and media. Sport is a platform that speaks to safeguarding. When girls hit the pitch, they're now visible. They're now not hidden. They're safeguarding and sport have a direct relationship, almost a brother-sister relationship. Sport has been known to be one of the major drivers of disseminating health messages. We've seen that in regions all across the world through the implementation of grassroots sport, which we are, you know, that's the crux of our movement. Sport has been shown to be a tool for reconciliation. You look no further than post, the region of the Balkans in the late 90s, using sport to bring people together at a time when division and isolation was so prevalent. And we're seeing that now. In fact, in 2019, Nia, just last year, we were very proud to welcome Alana Armitage, the regional director for UNFPA in Europe, to our World Games in Abu Dhabi. Many don't know, but the Special Olympics Saudi Arabia program, for the first time in their history, the history of the kingdom, sent 5 female athletes to represent the kingdom in Abu Dhabi. That is a small yet massive step forward in recognizing that what we're doing is working, but we're not done. And we have so much more to do. And that's why I'm glad that together Special Olympics and UNFPA and all of you are helping to fulfill that and accelerate that promise. I will say lastly that in the previous session, it was mentioned that in many ways, this work is kind of the equalizer. Sport has a unique ability to speak a universal language. In most cases, Nia, and to all of you, sport is the apolitical tool. Sport levels the playing field. It's the first language. I'm a father of 2 young children, and I remember their first language was not muchas gracias, it was not thank you, it was not mama, it was not papa, it was throwing a ball, it was rolling, it was hitting, it was all of those physical activities that speak a language. And so I think in large part, and I'll end here, Nia, the reason why sport is so important to girls with intellectual disabilities is not only because they gain opportunity, not only because they gain protection, not only because they're giving an opportunity to demonstrate their talents, but most of all, what UNFPA has given to girls with intellectual disabilities, and what I hope all of you will consider giving to girls with intellectual disabilities, is the chance to dream. Dream of being a champion. A champion as you spin, as DJ Switch just brilliantly showed us, a champion of fashion in media, just like we saw Claudia, a champion in the development and thought leadership spaces, just like Daniela showed, and so much more. I think together we can dream of crossing that finish line, and we can do it in style. Thank you very much.
Bravo. Gracias. Thank you, David. Yeah, that is so inspiring. I love it. So just to recap, you know, we are almost at the end, you know, just a few more minutes that we have, you know, for people that are watching us from all over the world. We just had our last three panelists, Daniela Ligeiro, which made a really good point of focusing on solutions and actions, and that everyone has a role to play. And Claudia Lemoore, when everyone told her that it was not possible, that she was crazy, that what was she thinking, opening a fashion magazine and doing all these awards and empowering women, that where will the funding come from? And she did not let negativity get into her head. Even when everybody said, no, it wasn't possible, she gathered her inner strength, empower herself and persevere. And now she has been an entrepreneur, successful entrepreneur for 11 years, starting from zero. So that's such an amazing point. And we have our last speaker of today, David Evangelista, our last panelist, how sports help girls to dream and to become champions in life, in everything that you want, and how sports is more than just sports and help us with our health and mental health, and gives opportunity for everybody in the world, you know, especially now during COVID-19. So thank you so much to all the panelists for everything that you have shared with us today. It's just so amazing, the atmosphere. I think it has emit an energy of inspiration and healing for the rest of the world. And now I would like to introduce Maria Rosa Cutillo, Chief of the Strategic Partnership Branch in UNFPA, who is spearheading the organization-wide effort to build strategic partnerships with private strategic partners to position UNFPA as a leader on the agenda of the organization. Maria Rosa is such an earth angel, with Jill's and Natalia and everybody at the UNFPA. So let's give her a warm welcome. Very warm welcome to Maria Rosa, which I think is right here. You are on mute. Yes, unmute.
Thank you. Great. Can you hear
Welcome.
Me? I just still 1 minute to thank you, Nia. I was saying, for your smile, your vibrant moderation, DJ Switch, your smile, your power. We are all very inspired. Thanks really from the heart to all our speakers, because you've been here today with us, but because you are with us every day. When we dream of a partnership, when we implement it, leaving no one behind, and with the spirit that Natalia was mentioning at the beginning, with humility and with the wish to learn from you. And thank you, Natalia, because your vision, your inspiration on partnerships, your support to our corporate effort is really motivating and supporting our day-to-day work on this. So thank you very much. I will close here, Nia, again. But I just wanted to say, I think we're sending a very strong message today. The power of partnerships can really be inspirational also in rethinking and reshaping multilateralism. I think we said it last year in Nairobi, but I think we're making a strong point on this also today. Thank you again. Over to you, Nia.
Thank you so much, Maria Rosa. This has been such an amazing event, and it takes such a powerful leader and team of people to bring all these amazing leaders together from around the world. Now, I would like to invite Dr. Natalia Kanem to deliver her closing remarks.
Well, thank you so much, and thank you, everyone. I will observe that COVID, this pandemic, tells us that we really need greater collaboration across mindsets, across borders, across sectors, across generations. And UNFPA stands united with our partners to invest in humanity and in the potential of every woman, every girl. And partnerships should be more than just a one-off project or an initiative. I think we learned that from the panel today. You're really about co-creating new frontiers filled with possibilities, with opportunities to make a new world better, hopefully greener, more sustainable. So I hope that we go forward, we identify our shared values, and we leverage all of our unique strength, the power that you spoke of. For UNFPA, we're 50 years old. There's only about 9 years left now till 2030. And what I want is to see a level of social impact where 10 years from now, we're not just regrinding the same thing, right? So I think as we transform our organizations and the work that we're doing for the women and girls we serve, to let them lead is really where we're going with this. This is a devastation, this pandemic. I think racism has been a devastation. Black lives do matter. And we also have seen how inequality, that's SDG 10, has really minimized our ability to share our ideas, our resources, our intelligence, our leadership, but we're getting around that and under less than ideal circumstances. So these protections that we're building across platforms of collaboration, that's a sign of resilience that I think is one of the shining lights of the power of partnership. So let's be inclusive when we do that. And I think we heard beautifully from David and others on that point. For my UNFPA team, thanks to you, you've done a beautiful job of pulling this next, what's next conversation together. I'd also like to thank the interpreters for your skills and your enthusiastic interest. We're really laying the foundation for a fully gender equal world. That's why we need partnership. And I want to thank everyone who's beamed in from all around the world today, especially, of course, our very insightful panelists. I want to continue in that spirit of sharing and learning from one another. So to me, what's next? We are in this race to the finish. The panel has said it well. So what's next is a world of no barriers, where women and girls' choices are respected, and where a girl can dream and have her dream become a reality. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Natalia, and thank you, everybody. We have reached the end of our What's Next session today. I hope that everybody is inspired and continue just growing and evolving. Arigato, gracias, merci. Thank you. Have a beautiful rest of the week. Bye.
Muchas gracias. Venga, hasta luego.